So we are back in Goa after 3 years. I can't believe it's been that long. And it's so nice to see so many old friends returning back for Publishing Next and to meet new people who are here to attend our conference. The hall is going to be filled up slowly, and by tomorrow we'll have a full house. But this year we are also doing something different from the past few years. We are going back to the basics. We are going to be unlearning, relearning everything that we know about this wonderful business called publishing. So welcome everyone. It's so wonderful to see you all here. This year we are also going to be balancing panel discussions with masterclasses and conversations, which will cover the main milestones of the publishing cycle as we know it. So I'll reserve more for the opening remarks tomorrow morning, and so we'll just, over the half day that we have today, we'll just dive straight into what we have in store and get a taste of what is to come in the next few days. So coming up, we have the first masterclass on editing with two master editors, Inda Chandrasekhar and Ritu Menon. Who'll take us through the demands of the editorial process and the rigor it calls for. Ritu Menon is the noted feminist publisher who co-founded Kali for Women and is the founder of Women Unlimited, an associate of Kali. She was awarded the Padma Shri in 2011, and she received the Women Impact Women Award by the Indian Chamber of Commerce and Industry in 2019. She is the author and editor of many books. Welcome, Ritu. And Indu Chandrasekhar is the publisher and managing director of Tulika Books, New Delhi, the venerable publisher of academic books in the social science and humanities, social sciences and humanities. She's also the founding partner of Independent Publishers Distribution Alternatives. Indu has worked closely with some of India's best known intellectuals and academics since she began her career with Macmillan in India in 1980s. Welcome, Indu. I'd like to invite you both up on the stage, please. And while they're walking up, I'd also like to add that it is with their support and encouragement and a few others that the Publishing Next 2019 has been possible. So I thank you very, very much for being here today. Have your green pens or pencils, please take them out, or you're welcome to take out red and black and magic ink if you like. Thanks.
Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you, Vinuta, for that introduction. It's great to be back in Goa, especially at Publishing Next. I've been here, I was trying to make a count yesterday. I think this is the fifth edition I'm present at out of the eight. And like she said, a lot of familiar faces. And we'll go straight into the session we have today. It's always a bit of a disadvantage to start off the proceedings because one doesn't have apart from the familiar faces, one doesn't have a sense of who exactly we are addressing, the delegates who've come. So Ritu and I were thinking it would be a good idea to see how many, firstly, of the delegates who've registered for Publishing Next are present here today. I know many people are coming in tomorrow. If you could just with a show of hands tell us how many delegates are here. Okay. Fine. So that's just about 10, 15 of them. And we'll then dive, and many of them are from our own publishing houses, so we don't need introductions beyond that, I guess. We'll leave introductions for later. So the way we thought we'd do this is, rather than make it a formal, you know, lecture or a class on editing, editing is something both Ritu and I have been involved in from for years together, for decades together, and we belong to that generation of publishers who set up our own publishing houses from editorial training that we received in other publishing houses. So we are editorial-led publishing houses, a tendency that is not necessarily true of the newer set, newer crop of publishing houses, especially the large publishing houses. Perhaps for that reason, editorial processes in many of the newer publishing houses, as well as some of the older publishing houses where we trained ourselves, seem to be less rigorous, absent in some cases, and different for sure. And it may be a good idea to go back to the basics of editing and putting a book together through editorial processes, we thought, for that reason, to reinforce, as it were, the importance of the editorial process and editors who lead that process, the different kinds of editing involved, and the different kinds of, the different categories of books or genres of books that need different approaches from editors. So we'd like to make this as interactive a session as possible. Ritu will start by giving a general introduction, an overview of editorial processes within publishing houses, the kinds of demands, the kinds of responsibilities editors have. And we'd like you to interject through soon after the introduction. If there are any questions you'd like, make it an interactive session rather than, you know, from into lecture mode session. So, having said that, Ritu.
You know, there are so many friends and colleagues from publishing that at least I feel a little foolish trying to speak about something that is very well known to many of you and from whom I dare say we could learn a thing or two, so it seems a bit silly to be sitting up here and trying to speak about trying to do a masterclass on editing. However, since we have been placed here, we may as well take the plunge. I didn't dare to do this, but last night I had a wicked thought after a couple of glasses of wine. And I thought, why don't we do this session as a series of stories? Why don't we just tell stories about different editorial projects and processes and challenges that we've had to face? And via those stories, we come to a few, let's say, facts or foundational things about what editing is. And then I thought, Leo will go up in smoke, so better not. But I will start with one story, which to me sort of, in a sense, exemplified the kinds of things that we are called upon to do, because let's face it, what is editing? What is it? I had a friend who was a film editor, and she was married to a very, very well-known Canadian documentary filmmaker called James Beveridge. His wife was Margaret Beveridge, who set up the Mass Communication and Research Film Center at Jamia Millia. She actually set it up. And she said to me one day, she said, you know, Everyone thinks Jim is a great filmmaker. Yes, he is. But nobody knows that his films are made on the editing table. And I'm the editor. We all know that films are made on the editing table. They are not made by the director necessarily. And I would say the same for books. Books are made on the editing table. But they can only be made on the editing table if the editor is very good, cares about what they're doing, treats each manuscript with the same attention, the same passion almost as any other. You cannot otherwise have a good book, because you cannot have a good relationship with your author. If you don't have a good relationship with your author, if you don't care about what they've done, you can't be a good editor. It's in my view, it's the bottom line. So this story I want to tell you is about a young girl whose personal story I read in a newspaper. And it was about her recovery, or what she called her recovery, from acute schizophrenia. It was the most extraordinary piece of writing because of what she said. So I thought, this is something I would like to know more about. It's a book I would like to publish. So I sort of managed to get a contact for her, and I wrote to her. And I said, I read this little thing that you wrote, and it would be really nice if you could do a book for us. So, no reply. About a week later, I get this very excited email saying, oh, I looked you up on the net, and gosh, you Kali for Women, I can't write for you. No, I can't write anything. It would be too difficult. So I wrote back and I said, okay, I mean, if you can't write, that's fine. But if you ever think of doing something, or if you have other pieces that you've got that, you know, you think you could send, please do that. No reply. 2 weeks later, I get another email saying, I've thought about what you asked me to do, and it's not going to be easy because it's a very painful process. So all I can say is that I'll send you an email every Monday in which I will write what I can. I said, fine. So for 1 year, she sent me an email every Monday, which she used to tap out on her phone, because half the time she wasn't able to get out of bed. And that 52 emails or more, because obviously some weeks she could send more, is what we published as a book. Now, the decision there was, and I'm taking this as an example to show that you never know when that editorial process begins. It does not necessarily begin with a manuscript landing on your table. It can begin much, much, much earlier. It can begin with someone you've never seen. It can begin with someone you don't know. It can begin with an idea. And it can begin and can be realized with the writer to make that book. But everything that you do in between is part of the editorial process. Everything is that relationship, not just with the printed word, but with the person who's writing it. And then with you as the person who is working on that. I do believe this, and I will say it without any hesitation, that there is not a single writer in the world who does not benefit from a good editor. A bad editor can be a catastrophe, but a good editor can only improve the work, and they should only improve the work. So I don't know really how much one can do in this 2 hours, but let me just quickly, and Indu, please come in, and everybody else who is familiar with this from the audience, please come in as well. There is no such thing as a single category editor. Every category of book requires a very different editorial intervention, and so it depends on what you're dealing with. You would have to be dealing and intervening in a very different way if you were looking at, let's say, poetry, and then you were looking at an academic text, you were looking at narrative nonfiction, you were looking at autobiography, or at a memoir, or at essays, or at short stories, or a novel. And each one of these requires a very different editorial input and a very different stage at which that editorial intervention is made. Because when do you intervene? When in that whole process of producing a book does the editor intervene? So what are we looking at least in general terms, regardless of the category of the book, regardless of the genre, what are we looking at? So I think, at least this is just a very rough kind of enumeration. What we're looking at is, of course, editing the content, that is what is in the book. We look at language, we look at presentation, we look at how the material has been organized, we look at repetition, we look at digression, we look at plagiarism. We look at something that I call overwriting, which is something that Indian writers are very, very, very susceptible to. We overwrite hugely in every category. I can say this without exception. And in translated works, in translations, in what is written in all our languages, A, there's no editing, B, there is overwriting, almost without exception. Almost without exception. What do you do with this as an editor? I don't know, we can talk about it later. But when it comes to taking these general sorts of features, you then have to decide what is it that you look for in each of the categories that you're dealing with. Obviously, what you look for in fiction is not the same as what you look for in a research-based academic work. It's not the same thing. So what are you looking for in each is the kind of initial response that you have to be aware of. At what stage would you intervene, given let's say a piece of work that comes to you? Do you intervene when the idea is born? Do you develop a manuscript with the author or the editor? Do you intervene when it comes to you? Do you intervene only when you begin to work on the manuscript? Do you intervene at every single stage? Is there a process of feedback, a back and forth that continues over many weeks, many months, however long it might take, or whatever the nature of the book is? How to establish a relationship with an author? I think this is one of the most difficult relationships that there is. Because, of course, every publisher depends on the fact that an author will become a repeat author, that they will come back to you, that that experience would have been satisfying enough and worthwhile enough and beneficial enough for them to come back to you. But in order for an author to come back to you, there has to be a relationship that you develop with them. And how is that relationship to be developed? I know that there are editors who have an extremely, or shall I say, a purely professional relationship with the authors. And in my experience, I have never had an author, or I have seldom had an author who hasn't ended up becoming a very good friend, even if they never publish with me again. Now, for me, that relationship is a relationship that emerges from working on what is possibly the author's most important expression, which is their book. There is no more intimate relationship than working with an author on what they wish to express, on how they wish to communicate it, and on the success of that expression and that communication. It is an extremely intimate relationship. I don't think it can become impersonal. I'm willing to be proved wrong, but I don't think it can be an impersonal relationship. And so I admire the editors who say that, you know, of course a professional relationship doesn't mean it's not a relationship of caring. Of course it is. But I'm talking about something different. This young woman whose example I gave you earlier, we published her book about 5 years ago, she sends me an email almost every month telling me what she's doing and where she is and how she's going about it and so on. I'm still hoping she'll write that sequel. But in the meantime, if she's doing all these other things, it's part of my relationship with her. And whether she writes another book or not really will be the bonus, if I can use that word. I'm absolutely sure, I can say that, I'm absolutely sure that when she does write that book, she will come only to me. She will not go to anyone else. And I say so without being immodest, that is true of most of my authors. They will not go to someone else. They may be tempted, many of them are, and now there's so much big money that's available that many of them will go. That's an inevitability, but I'm saying it is surprising how many come back. Because that relationship is a very, very important part of what editing is. Any editing that you do is an intervention. Whether it's language, or it's organization, or it's chopping, changing, never rewriting, although one is tempted to do that often, but an editor's job is not to rewrite. An editor's job is to enhance what the author has written. It is not my job to write the author's book. That's their job. My job is to make sure that whatever they're trying to write or say is communicated and written and presented in the best possible way. That's my job. My job is not to tell them how to write or to rewrite their sentences, because there is something very important which sometimes editors tend to forget, which is the authorial voice. That voice has its own integrity. I don't have to replace that voice with my voice. So I do not rewrite. I'm not supposed to rewrite. And if it requires that kind of rewriting, it must go back to them. They must then recast, rewrite, revise, review, whatever is required. But it's not for me to do that. That's not my role. So when does this process begin? As I said, it can begin with the idea. It can begin if you are developing a manuscript together. And some of the most exciting editorial experiences actually is to develop a book together. And I don't know an editor who has not found this a very creative experience, because it is a very satisfactory, if it works well and you can actually bring it to fruition. It is a wonderful experience to work from the stage of the idea to develop the book and then to see it through right till the end. It is really one of the most gratifying collaborations that you can have. So it can begin there. And many times these things do not actually materialize. Very often that collaboration may not work. It may not, for many different reasons. But when it does work, it is very wonderful. And mostly, I can't say always, but in my experience, mostly what you get is a good book. You get a book that perhaps the author would not have done on their own. This is something very interesting that I've found. I have worked with writers who would not have done something on their own. But if you work with them collaboratively on something, you can actually produce a pretty good book. And by good, what is a good book, someone asked me. Someone did an interview a long time ago and said, so what in your opinion is a good book? Meaning, you know, a book that sells 20,000 copies and a book that makes the author a celebrity, etc. And I said, in my view, a good book is a book that endures. If 5 years after it's written, 10 years after it's written, that book is still around, that's a good book. It's a good book regardless of how many copies it might have sold. If it's still around, it means it is relevant. And if it's relevant, it's worth doing. It's worth doing. It's worth persevering with it. It's worth keeping it going. Do you begin to edit when the manuscript comes to you, lands on your table? Or does that process begin when, let's say for academic books, which Indu will talk about, you send it out for review. You send it to better known people in the field, whatever the subject might be, and ask them to tell you whether it's worth publishing or not. Is that part of the intervention? I think it can be. In my view, in India, in the academic environment, everybody knows everybody. There are very, very few good reviewers who are not known to the author. Very few. So it becomes incumbent on the editor, or shall I say editor stroke publisher, to send that manuscript out for review when they are reasonably sure that they will get a fair assessment, and not an assessment that might be influenced by all kinds of other associations that the reviewer might have with the author. It is a very common pitfall, very common. So that's an intervention that you make. At a stage when you intervene and send a manuscript back for revision, that is an editorial intervention. When it comes back to you, that is an intervention. And so it continues till the editing stage. One thing that we don't do very often, that we didn't used to do, but I think is becoming more and more important now to do, is what is called fact-checking. In a sort of internet and Wikipedia friendly world, authors very often do not check the facts that they send in, that they write. And if you take it on trust, which is what one is supposed to do, that the author after all is responsible for what they've said, the sources they've cited, the people they've quoted, the data they are presenting, etc., etc., then you take it on trust. You say, well, yes, they must have done their homework and they know what they're doing. But increasingly, even authors are looking to Wikipedia and internet sources for referencing. This can be quite risky, especially in academic work, not so much in what we call general interest or trade, but in academic work it can be quite hazardous not to be mindful of this, not to do this as a matter of course. So, I don't know that I want to add too much more to the general part of it, but I do think that maybe Indu, you could say a few things about the, you know, the academic.
Yeah, just to add a little to what Ritu's already said. It's striking how, without discussing it, there are phrases that Ritu has really echoed. This is something, and my colleagues here will bear me out. Most independent publishers, for sure, and good editors, good defined in the way Ritu has defined it, will end up, the relationship with the author is so important to them that if they're not already friends when they've started out, they end up becoming friends by the end of that process. And that's a great sense of satisfaction for the editor concerned. And that whole process of sending out author queries, receiving feedback from authors, developing the manuscript, getting irritated with each other, all of that is part of the territory, right? Where you're trying to convince the author of something, the author is trying to convince you of something else, etc., etc. So that is one thing I just wanted to remark on. And also to go on to say that the relationship of an editor establishes and develops is not just with the author in the bookmaking process, but with other departments of the bookmaking process, as it were. You develop a relationship with the typesetter, the designer, you know, the production, so-called production area, department, with the paper dealer, with the printing press, because these are choices that are actually ideally driven to begin with by the editor and not left to the production person in your organization or to the marketing person in your organization. An editor at least has to be involved, I would imagine, at each of these stages. So the relationship with the book is primarily with the author, obviously, of the book, but also to go on to develop a relationship. So just to expand on what Ritu said there. And I think these relationships, developing these relationships, are easier for editors in independent run publishing houses, probably, having just comparing my experience of working in a large publishing house with very compartmentalized division of responsibilities and comparing it to Tudeka, where the way we work is may seem ad hoc and anarchic at times, but there's a system in the madness, there is a method, and all of us try to, there's one demand, almost a demand that I make of all my colleagues who are editors, which is please learn every step of bookmaking. Don't restrict yourself to desk editing or editing on your computers. Go out there, dirty your hands, visit a printing press, figure out why we choose a certain kind of paper for a certain kind of book. These are editorial choices at the end of the day, because we do not bring out standardized products. Each book that we make and develop with an author has to have a certain, even in a narrow category called academic publishing, which is the only world that I know of publishing, even there the kind of choices you make for different kinds of books can affect the readership of the book, the look of the book, etc., etc. And the relationship with the author is important because you know, there's someone to share the excitement of developing that book together. The choices you make, like I said, of paper, format, font, typography, designer, etc., etc., these are things that if you bring the author in on it, most authors, by the way, are very happy to participate. It's because we do not have the time sometimes or the wherewithal that we deny them that opportunity. I found this. Among the authors we've published, even in academic publishing, there are at least 70 to 80% of authors who are very, very happy to be involved in the developing of the bookmaking process and to see, to be happy at the end of the day, oh, now I understand why you chose this paper. Now I understand why you moved to a royal size rather than a demi size for this particular book or to crown. Now I understand why you asked me to give you images in a certain resolution, etc., etc. So you know, it's an education process both ways, I think, for editors as well as authors. What else? We don't have time to go into the nitty-gritty of editing, but most of academic publishing is based on you know, scholarly research made by either young researchers or experienced scholars in the field concerned. And I cannot emphasize enough the importance of fact-checking on the one hand that Ritu has mentioned. And fact-checking, you could check the facts with the author herself. You know, you could just query it, say, this somehow does not make sense, or but does not make logical sense. Would you consider looking at it or referring to it one more time? And the author most often is quite happy to get that input from an editor. And the other thing is plagiarism. Now, plagiarism is actually a big area in academic publishing, which, you know, teachers in universities and colleges struggle with on a day-to-day basis where their students are concerned, and now they have very well-developed software to detect, you know, plagiarism of large chunks of text which you borrow without permission from other scholars. But what do you do with plagiarism of ideas? I've come across this once or twice. Where one academic says, you know, this is an idea that I have developed in my work and so-and-so has taken that idea. It's a very gray area. There are no hard and fast rules, you know. But it's something we should be aware of, that you could have plagiarism or copying of that kind as well. And if it, you know, results in a legal dispute, what happens then? So a publisher or an editor very often has to act as mediator, as it were, and try and understand the law on it first, and if it is, if things are moving to a fractious position, or you know, try and convince them that, listen, not everyone has an original idea in every book he or she writes. Yeah, so it could be that there is an influence in terms of the idea, but you cannot equate it to. So this is also a role an editor has to play, like being a mediator between. And an editor need not be, as Ritu mentioned, a specialist in the field she edits. But she has to be a generalist, an intelligent general reader of every subject, in academic publishing particularly. Very often my colleagues ask me, do I need to be a historian in order to, you know, edit a book by a scholar of history? I'm not a historian, but you do need to have, possess a sense of logic, a sense of how a book needs to be structured. You have a sense of what the readership of that book is, and therefore you make those suggestions to the author based on that. Some experienced authors don't need it, but younger authors, especially younger scholars, are quite happy to be in conversation with you without necessarily rubbing them up the wrong way. Beyond that, you know, then there's the nitty-gritty of editing, where you always, actually in book publishing, this is one point I think that needs to be made. An editor is comparatively, relatively a very anonymous person, especially as compared to journalism, where many writers get a byline or get recognized for whatever they do. Even subs sometimes get a byline. In a book, if the author acknowledges the editor who's worked on her book, it's a big thing. And that's the only acknowledgement you can hope for. So it's a very anonymous job. It's also a very taxing and meticulous job. You put in a lot of your work. You have to maintain the author's voice, as Ritu mentioned. You can't rewrite the book in your own voice. Again, I compare it to journalism, where the house style demands that you rewrite copy. Copy editing in a book publishing house means necessarily that you recognize the authorial voice, the idiosyncrasies in that author's voice, and put yourself anonymously, as it were, into her shoes, and edit a text to make better transparent sense to the reader. For lack of time, I mean, I think that about encapsulates the process of editing. And whether it's hard copy editing or soft copy editing, and relationship with the author in terms of not giving in to the author's demands all the time. That's not the point. But taking it on board, figuring out, discussing it with your colleagues, and then arriving at a collective decision very often, which is conveyed to the author probably by a single editor or by a collective editorial decision.
I think, what else can we add?
You know, there's one thing that that perhaps we should have mentioned, which is very often in the independent publishing houses, the editors are actually deciding what should be published as well. Yeah. Meaning, we are not just, we are also deciding whether we should develop a particular, how is a list developed and how do you develop your program? That's in the smaller houses, which are editorially driven. It is the editors who decide that this is the way that list is going to develop. Whichever decision they make, whatever kind of choices they, but that is an editorial decision. It's not made by the, whoever the publisher, owner, whoever may be. It could be, it need not be, but it very often, it is editors who are decide. We are editor publishers, I'm an editor publisher. I'm a publisher, but I'm also the editor. So is Indu, so is Sudhu. So are many people in this room. Now, that dual role has a particular kind of contradiction inbuilt into it. Because obviously, as the publisher, your preoccupations are with another set, an additional set of factors. How much do you invest? What is a fair return? How long should the gestation period of a particular project or a particular series be? What sort of return do you expect on it? When do you get that return? Should you continue with it? Should you discontinue it? Do you have the wherewithal to begin an entirely new set of, for instance, I'm a publisher in the English language. I decide I want to start doing translations. Is that an editorial decision or the publisher decision? In our case, it's my decision. Call it autocratic. I don't have to ask anybody. It's my responsibility whether I lose money on it, make money on it, whether it goes anywhere, whether it sinks into a bottomless well, whether it acquires a huge profile. Those are the risks I take. Risk taking is something editors do. We take risks. We take risks when we decide to publish something that might seem totally unpublishable, totally. It's happened to me in the past, and I hope it will happen again. I want to give you an example of one particular book that we are doing right now by an academic, I'm not taking names, who went to Oxford University Press, because all academics want to go to Oxford University Press, because why? It's 500 years old and it's got Oxford in the name. Never mind that they do no editing. But it's got Oxford in the name. Plus, you are with Amartya Sen, and you know the kind of peer pressure that many academics have to work under. So she sends it to Oxford University Press, and they say, oh yes, very good manuscript, a very good project, and we will send it out for review. Off it goes for review. To two reviewers, that's a good idea, send it to more than one so that you have, you know, another opinion in addition to your own. And the reviews come back saying, what a terrible, terribly written book, no language, no organization, no presentation. How can a press like Oxford University even consider something like this? Goes back to the author, saying our reviewers have, unfortunately, have given an unfavorable review, and so we will decline. Okay? She sends me an email. I've written this book, it was my PhD thesis, and would you like to take a look? I said, yeah, I'll take a look, it's an interesting subject. So she sends it to me. And I read it. And it is terribly written. And it is very badly presented. And it needs to be reorganized. And it has the most fantastic ethnographic information in it. Done for the very first time. So I hold my head in my hands and I say, what am I going to do with this book? So I write to her and I say, we will publish it. Oh, she says, that's wonderful, that's great. I said, no, but you have to work on it. We are not going to do it until you and I work on it. Now, the thing is, here's the trick. She could very well have said, well, run along. I'm not going to do any more work on it. I've done what I had to do. I've got my PhD on it. It's obviously good enough for a PhD. PhD from the UK, some university, okay? Not from some, you know, a competition college in Dharamsala or somewhere, okay? So I don't think I need to do any work on it, but that those two reviews that she got are in the back of her head and she thinks maybe there's something to this. But it means she has to work very hard and it means I have to work very hard to tell her exactly how to rework it. Because obviously if she could have done it herself, she would have done it the first time around. Why would she have waited? She did not know. Or she did not think about it enough, or she did not have the time enough, whatever reason, I don't want to speculate. The fact of the matter is that she didn't do it. I did 3 edits on that book. That is unacceptable anywhere in an academic or a large publishing house because the economics of it are totally unviable. I cannot spend that much of my time on a single book. But I did. And she did too. And in the end, we have a first-rate book. Now, that is what I do as an editor. I hope I don't have to do it very often, but I do. And in fact, very soon after that, what do I get? I get a manuscript of 125,000 words, which is an obscenely long book, would be an exorbitantly expensive book to produce, which would mean I would have to price it out of the market, which means it would be sitting in the godown, and which means that the author would never get the kind of acknowledgement for what she has done that perhaps she should. So we reduce it by 35,000-40,000 words. Now, that is reducing it by a third. It's a challenge. It is a challenge to reduce a manuscript of that extent by one third because short of recasting it, what do you do? What do you do with that? Now, obviously, this author has a very discursive style, a very rambling voice. She goes off at a tangent, she digresses, so as an editor, what do I have to do? I have to make bloody sure that the argument she is making is in the foreground. It is not drowned under the digressions and the asides and the detail and all of which is interesting, but my goodness, do I have the time to read that as a reader? Do I have the time to do that? It's all very important for her, but is it very important for the reader? Which is my decision. I have to step in as not just the editor, but the potential reader. But in this case, in order to work on that manuscript, I have to be pretty confident of what I'm doing. I can't go at it fumbling and stumbling, because I can wreck that manuscript. If I go into it with insecurity, I really have to be pretty confident of what I want to do with it in order to do that kind of reduction, most often it doesn't get done because it is fairly daunting. And when it doesn't get done, you can tell. By the way, adding on to what Indu said about anonymity, I have one axiom which I use, which is, you never know who the editor is of a book because their name never appears in it. But you jolly well know when a book has not been edited. You know it immediately. You know that this book has not had the kind of attention that it needed, that it deserved. Every book deserves that attention. And if you think it's not worth it, don't do it. Decline it. The country is filled with books that should never have seen the light of day. I do say this, I say it unabashedly. Between 40 to 50% of books that are published today in this country should never have seen the light of day. Never. It's a waste not only of people's time and money, it's a waste of energy. And why? Oh, why? Why do we need all those books? What for? I mean, I'm not going to go into that now. That's the whole discussion. Better not get into it at this point of time. But it is something that I think over the course of the next 2 days will come up for discussion. It will feature. Because I perhaps should repeat that everything that Indu and I have been saying is something that we can afford to do because we are very small. We are very small. And when I say very small, I really mean very small. Because the kind of attention that we are talking about is totally impractical in a larger publishing house. It cannot happen unless you have 50 editors. And no one has them. No one has them. No large publishing house has that kind of editorial skill and team available anymore. Everywhere in the world, editing has been outsourced to freelancers for academic books and to literary agents for trade books. Literary agents today are playing the editor's role across the English-speaking world in the West. Not Europe, but UK and the US, definitely. The editor is now the literary agent. The literary agent vets the manuscript before submitting it to any publishing house, any. No editors, very few editors edit. The kind of editing that we are talking about, and maybe we are being foolish. Maybe we are. I don't know. Maybe this role is unaffordable now. And I think that that's a discussion that we should be prepared to have. Are we redundant? What is it that we are doing? I mean, I'm speaking for myself, I never go to a freelance editor because I have to edit the damn thing again when it comes back. Because there's no such thing, there are no skills, no one's training anybody. Large publishing houses, the big multinationals, apologies to Harper and Hachette and others, are they training anybody? Are they? I don't see it. I don't see it in their books, and I certainly don't see it among their employees. So who's doing it? Where is this skill being developed today? Where is it possible to acquire this experience? Who has the time? Who has the time to do it? Do I have the time to teach? I have young colleagues. Do I have the time to teach? Well, I try. But I can tell you that it protracts the process, which makes no economic sense. None. And frankly speaking, the only way we survive, the only way we are able to do it is because our books seldom go out of print. So they keep selling. Slowly, but they keep selling, which means that at the end of a certain period of time, you have, you know, 100 or 200 or 300, whatever books that are still in the market, on which you have spent time 20 years ago, 15 years ago, whenever it was. But I'm saying as a skill, it's in very short supply now, very short supply. So I don't know what this masterclass will actually, you know, mean. If the possibility of doing your best as an editor may not exist, I know that I have published with Oxford University Press myself, and I know that of the books they did, to one of which my co-author and I had a US publisher, an academic publisher, I had to edit the book again after it was published by OUP before sending it to the US. What does that mean? This is Oxford University Press. This is their job. They are subsidized. They don't pay taxes, or they didn't. For a very long time, Oxford University Press paid no taxes in India. None. It was their most successful operation in the worldwide. What are they doing? They have fired 40 editors in the last 3 months. 40, 4-0. So what are we? I mean, I don't know. Sorry, I shouldn't be saying this here. But I'm just saying, look, this is the reality. And what we are saying is in an ideal kind of situation. It's a desirable situation. And we wish that it would be much more common, much more commonly sort of practiced, I suppose. I don't know. What do we do now?
Yeah, I think on that note, before we start ranting against editorial, I mean publishing houses that don't have, which is true, I mean it's to do with also a comparison with what we started out with, you know, when we were editors. I must say I'm grateful for the publishing houses I worked with, because they taught me everything I know about publishing today. Having set up my own publishing house, I tried to carry those, each of us, when I say I'm talking about all of us who are in the independent publishing, who are heading up independent publishing houses, we try to take those standards forward, to develop, to move with the times, learn new things, etc. And our mentors, as it were, have abandoned that job and are, so it is depressing. And when Ritu and I and other friends get together, this is all we can talk about. So now maybe we should ask for questions, or if we've missed out on anything that you would like us to cover. Yeah, there is a lot of nitty-gritty of editing, what we need to do, but do you think we should just invite some questions at this stage? And then we can probably fill in the gap in those ways.
Question. Oh, first question. Any other questions? Nobody else is putting up a hand. Only Terry. 1 second.
Ritu, and, thank you very much. That was a very interesting and slightly dispiriting talk. But, you know, at the beginning, Ritu, you said something about a good editor and a bad editor. Now, I think also, you know, from the author's point of view, everyone who writes thinks they're writing a good book. You know, you don't think you're writing, you don't deliberately write a bad book. And I don't think anyone is deliberately setting out to be a bad editor either. But what makes a bad editor a bad editor? What makes a good editor a good editor? What's the difference?
I'd say a bad editor is one who couldn't give a shit about the author's work. And they shouldn't be editing it. As I said in this, I mean, I thought I had somehow managed to say what I think a good editor is. See, if you don't care about an author's writing, you should not be editing it. You really shouldn't be editing it. I have to care about the book that will finally be read. What should it be? Should someone actually want to read it? Should someone finish reading it? I can start a book and say, enough. My job as a good editor is to do my damnedest to see that that book, when it is picked up to be read, is finished. When it is picked up to be read, actually makes the point it's making. When it is picked up to be read, makes a contribution, let's say, to social science, to history, to economics, to politics, to you name it, that biography, that memoir, that autobiography tells me something that I didn't know I wanted to know. But now that I know it, I'm glad for that book. A bad editor is the one who destroys the author. And it happens. The example I gave you of that scholar who was turned down, do you know, I met the publisher at OUP much later, and she said, what are you working on now? And I gave her this. Oh, she said, has it come to you? I said, yes, why? Of course, I knew where it had been. She said, do you know, we made a very big mistake with that book. I said, what was the mistake? You sent it out to review, you got very bad responses from the reviewers. She said, no. The editor who was in charge of that manuscript should never have declined it on the basis of those reviews. He should have consulted the author and asked her if she was willing to rework. He should not simply have declined it. She was right. And that editor was wrong. In my view, that's an editor who didn't care. Because those editors are not working on the manuscripts. They are just pushing paper. And the manuscript goes out to a freelancer to edit who certainly doesn't care about the book. It's just a job. They certainly do not care about that book. So you see what that intervention, also an intervention, did. It was totally, an immature decision at best, if I were to be charitable. And if I were to be uncharitable, I would say, well, he didn't know his elbow from his ass. Because you should be able to tell. When you look at a manuscript, you should be able to see the nugget there. It's your job to shape it with the author. It's your job. That's a good editor. You shape it. That's editing. It's shaping the book.
So to take off from that point, so to take off from there about good editors and bad editors, what are the qualities? How do you train an editor who cares, perhaps, but is just not good enough? There are two parts to this question. One is it something intangible? Is it something intuitive? Is it something so intangible and intuitive that you just know an editor is good when he or she has done so many books and messed them up or, you know, improved them? And the other part of my question is, today, and this is not to malign anything or anybody, but would you think that the younger crop of editors who come in the English book publishing world, they don't even know their English well enough. So where is the strength of the editing? You've at least got to have your language right. You know, and then there is this whole mix of American English and UK English. When you say a publishing house has a house style, and we follow the English UK style and the American style. So now there is such a mix of English. Is that important anymore? I think I'm confusing a lot of issues, but basically this is all puts in my head.
I just want to, I know it's to take this question. I know everyone else sitting here, Ravi and so many other publishers, editors here, all of you, all of whom will have something to say, I'm sure. But talking about young editors, young crop of editors who don't even have the language, now I will take names because the author is very, very, very happy that names be taken. Keki Daruwala rang me up one morning and said, Ritu, what is happening to all these young editors? I said, why are you asking me that, Keki? I don't have any. So he said, no, you know, Simon & Schuster, such a good publishing house. I kept very quiet. such a good publishing house. And look at what this editor has done? I said, what has she done? He said, this is what I wrote. Something or the other, and he was so annoyed or so unhappy that he lost his shirt. I said, okay, so that's all right. What? He said, no, she changed it to he lost his shit. I said, what? He said, she changed it to lost his shit. I said, what? What did you say to him? He said, I told her, I said, it is not lost his shit. So I said, and what did she say? She said, no, Mr. Daruwala, I looked up the thesaurus and it says they are interchangeable.
What?
It's an idiomatic phrase. And so they are interchangeable. We can go with the lost his shit. Do you know the printed book has lost his shit? And I was telling Ravi last night that I finished reading a book just 2 days ago in which kowtow is spelled as C-O-W. I think that's appropriate.
That's because cows are the flavor.
But I'm saying this is...
And that's exactly what I mean.
It's a Penguin Viking book that was a Simon & Schuster book. I can assure you it would never have passed muster with any of us. Never. Now, the question about good or bad...
No, basically, if an editor does not have... Editors are hired or enter publishing houses for different tasks and responsibilities. Not all of them need to... have the best English, but there's also a collegiate atmosphere where you can check, you have aids like dictionaries, thesauruses, and now if an editor is not willing to go through all of that, obviously, then that person does not deserve to job. But it's not, editing is not merely a skill set, is the point I think Ritu was trying to make, that you're over and beyond that. So a good editor is also an editor who can see a gap in the literature and who says, okay, this book, you know, we need to develop a book in this area because it doesn't exist. Or a good editor is an editor who takes a risk and publishes something that another publisher will not publish for the wrong reasons, for the wrong political or social reasons or legal reasons. So a good editor can be defined in many ways, but there are certain... good editor in-house, like all of us do. They don't come with any training.
It responds to the fact that you don't care. You might care, you just don't have it in you.
Yeah. So if you don't have it in you, you shouldn't be.
So then you become what they call a publicist. Yeah. And you promote the book because you care about
it. In fact, we do this quite often, Leah, and you're aware of it. You know, some of us run internship programs, and my sense of running an internship programs with young people who want to just join a publishing house, why do you want to? Because I love books, I love reading books. You know, that's the first point, which is a fine point, I think, entry point. And then you say to that person, listen, publishing comprises many aspects. You may not be very good at editing, but you could be good at maintaining a website, being a publicist, doing marketing, social media, production. So there are many roles to an editor, I think, in an independent publishing house, and he or she may fit into any of those roles. So that's another way of looking at it, no? Hi.
Hi. My question is very specific to children's literature. So when we actually produce, when we have been producing books for early grader students, and these books needs to be, these pictures book needs to be practiced in classroom that the teachers read. I mean, for them to read, we definitely have decodable books. But when we are bringing children's literature books, because the teachers needs to work with a lot of voice modulation and how the book needs to be read aloud, we kind of like play with the font style. So we as an editor or a publishing, how do we ensure, and because we have been given a lot of review by a lot of users or like, you know, critique that a font should be something for a children's literature book that it's actually readable to these young kids. But because early graders, they wouldn't read those books, it's being read to them by their teachers. How do we ensure, or what is the best thing to follow? Is it, do we need to focus on how it needs to be practiced in a classroom, or do we need to cater what a reader would be able to do when they have the book and they are able to read? How do we manage that?
I think there are conventions, but the best person to answer this question is the So you're saying, one, it should be readable, that the font should be readable? Absolutely. So you do have point sizes depending on the age. You have the simplicity of the font. You also have a playfulness of the font in places where you want to make it look attractive. You know, if someone's screaming, you increase the point size. You play around like that. But there was another part to your question which I didn't quite get.
Do we need to stick to the standard fonts, or can we be, I mean, like, because we are working with picture books, it needs to be some parts of it.
We don't stick to standard fonts. We try as many fonts as we like and as are available, and English has huge variety of fonts, but just stick to at least the things that about legibility, I mean, of the font, the readability of the font, the play for the, sorry? Yeah, absolutely. I think we should be, as long as the basis is that you shouldn't have the kind of fonts that are so playful that that an F looks like an E, an inverted or something like that, which might get difficult for children to read. Again, is it a read aloud book or is it something children are reading? It depends on all of that. But I think playing with fonts is something we love doing.
Just to add to that, I think where you're coming from, there has been a convention. It's not true of Tulika Publishers, Chennai, but there is a convention of educational textbooks for children which use the most boring fonts, the most boring layouts, and the most boring illustrations. And these are to do with the, very often with the prescribed textbooks, CRT or SCERT textbooks. But that's something that has started changing. And I think that change started when private publishers led the way, you know. Institutions that were government prescribed textbooks started looking towards some innovation within the circle, the framework that they are allowed.
Monica?
Let me come to you in a minute.
Behind you. Jerry?
Hi, good evening, everyone. I'm Carlos Lewis. Good evening, ma'am. I have two questions. Basically, when all of India has a number of authors coming up, and I was just thinking whether a relationship between an author and the editor, is it really possible at this point of time when the number of authors are going up? And secondly, does the editor have in mind regarding the book, I mean, when it is published, does the editor have in mind also about its sales, also about the marketing of the book?
You know, that first part of your question is actually very interesting, because one of the topics that we didn't touch upon at all is self-editing. Now, why I say this is because, and Leo and others will bear me out, this number of authors growing is a consequence of something that has developed pretty rapidly called self-publishing in India. The amount of self-publishing that is done today is sort of incrementally higher than what it was ever the case. Now, who edits these authors? Most of the time, they are self-editing. That is, they say they edit themselves. And in fact, I think that that is something that that in my view is not an author's job. It's not an author's job to edit themselves. They cannot. I speak as an author, by the way. You cannot edit yourself. It's very difficult. However disciplined, and I'm an editor too. I mean, I'm speaking as somebody who has had an experience of that. But you, it is not possible to do justice to your work as an author if you are editing yourself. And I say this to all self-published authors, whoever, you know, is stupid enough to ask me. Thank goodness they don't ask me very often. Why does self-publishing not use professional editing? Two reasons in my view. One, you have to pay for it. And two, there are not that many professional editors around. This is precisely what we spoke about earlier. If I'm self-publishing and I want my work to be edited professionally, I want to be pretty sure that I'm getting a good person to do it. How do I do that? Let's say I'm looking for that. I, as an author, I'm actually interested in having my work looked at by a professional. How do I do it? There are no websites, there are no lists, there's no listing, there's nothing. It's just word of mouth. There are one or two agencies. There used to be one in Bangalore called Jacaranda, which provided this service. There are one or two others now that help authors to self-publish, and they do provide that service. But by and large, it's not available. So, I mean, how can you blame those authors for putting their work out the way it was written? You will find authors who refuse to be edited. We all know them. They write by the yard. Their books are sold by the yard. They refuse to be edited. They write it into the contract that they will not be edited. A huge disservice to themselves, in my view. A huge disservice. So, it's a matter for consideration.
Marketing.
Well, of course we are, but I mean, we are not always in a position to do the kind of marketing and promotion that is required. People like us are saying the larger publishing houses have departments, have their separate divisions doing all that. And yes, there is a very significant amount of coordination that goes on there. You know, there was a very interesting thing that, I mean, I'm just putting it out as a part response to your question. When I started publishing, I was in New York, started working in a publishing house. I was in New York and I worked with a very large trade publisher, independent, called Doubleday. And Doubleday now is part of the Knopf group, Random House, Knopf. You don't know who belongs where anymore. But Doubleday started a division called Market Research. It was an editorially driven publishing house. I'm talking about the early 70s, early 70s. Every decision was taken by the editor-in-chief, by the editors. They were the czars of the publishing house. Their word was law. Nobody could contravene the editor. What they decided was published. Along comes this Market Research division, where I found a job. Because I needed a job. What was my job? Very interesting. This is early 70s. For them to have anticipated what was going to be happening to trade publishing. First, I had to read all the congressional records, that is, the records from the US Congress, to see what the allocations were on education. What were the budgetary and policy allocations made on education? How much money was going to be released? I didn't think it had anything to do with what we were publishing, but the publishing house had an educational unit, which was Pfeffer and Simon, which published educational books. So pretty soon I told my boss, I said, this is very boring, I'm not going to do it, please give me something else to do. Okay, he says, why don't you look at whether we should be publishing first novelists? Should the publishing house publish a first novelist? I said, what does that mean? So he said, well, the writer could be a very well-known poet and has now written a novel. Should be publishing her, whoever. How should I find out? How can I make that decision? That's an editorial decision. It's not a marketing decision. No, he said. Look up all the first novelists published by all our competitors. Now, in the US, there is a fantastic resource called the Literary Marketplace. Literary Marketplace is a compendium brought out by the publishing industry that lists every single title published in the US in a given year, calendar year. So you go to Literary Marketplace and you look up all the, and they categorize. So you look up all the novels, the first novelist published by, let's say, five of our competitors. I thought, this is a mug's game. I mean, what am I going to do with all this? No. So you get all those from all the competitors, let's say five of similar standing. And then you go to another wonderful resource called the Book Review Digest. And you look at the reviews that these writers have got. And you correlate the reviews, their reception in the market. No way of telling that, but you can gauge in some ways. You go to bookshops, you get some sales figures, stop yawning, Jerry. And you tabulate this. And on the basis of that, it is then that information is fed to the editors, and it became over time, it became a factor. Now I'm saying we have salespeople telling the editors what to publish. The marketing.
Yeah, that changes.
If they agree, it's fine.
Track changes, send it to them. Say, look, this is what I did. They can say yes or no.
They can say yes or no.
Yeah, so you just.
You have to work with them. You have to work with them. But I can tell you, and this is an experience that many of us have. You edit, you try to achieve what Indu mentioned, clarity, directness, readability, blah blah, etc. And you do your best, and you try damn hard to retain the author's voice. And the author comes back and said, oh, but you have totally flattened it. Have we all heard this word? You have flattened it.
All the
excess has gone. Five adjectives which are saying the same damn thing. We've all encountered that. And that, they say, but that's my style. So it's my job to say, look, that's not your style. That's your overindulgence. That's not a matter of style. Style is what I'm trying to preserve. What you're trying is excess. Excess is not style. But how many times we have come across authors who say, you flattened what I wrote, this is not my voice. So then I say, I've said this to at least three authors, look, what you mean by your voice is what it sounds like when you're talking to me across the table. A conversational voice. That is not the same as a written voice. The way you talk to me across the table is not the same as what you do when you put pen to paper. Because the reader is not across you on the table. The reader is sitting with the book in their hands, and they're trying to, with sincerity, they're trying to understand what you're saying. But if I'm talking across the table like this, we can clarify each other immediately. It's conversation. A book is not conversation in the same sense. Not the same sense. So the written word is not the same as the spoken word. But often when authors say, this is not my voice, what they mean is, this is not what I sound like. Sound like. So what is it that they sound like? It's a fairly slippery slope. I have to say that. It's a very slippery slope. And in manuscripts that require a lot of work, it's a slope that you often fall off while editing. You can do.
Actually, to give you an example also, especially in academic writing among senior scholars, I've come across young editors who get terribly fed up with a slightly old world way of phrasing an argument. Okay? Now the point is, and I've often had to, in one instance actually, the editor concerned changed several sentences thinking it's wrong English, and actually changed the meaning, you know, said the opposite of what, and it resulted in her having to leave Tulika, probably the first instance, because she wouldn't admit to having made a very bad mistake, because the scholar objected. Now, and you know, a slightly old world way of phrasing your argument is something we come across with quite a few of our senior scholars. Senior, I mean, in experience in terms of authorship, etc. They're considered absolute experts in their discipline. So I would tread very carefully and advise editors in Tulika, my colleagues, to tread carefully. You know, basically, I mean, it's often an instruction saying, oh, it's so-and-so's book, don't over-edit. Because her language and her way of putting across the argument is integral to her style, in one sense, to her. And she has established her reputation as an academic based on that kind of presentation. So you can't, you know, if you have an obviously a paragraph, a sentence that's a paragraph long, then you try and intervene. But if you have lengthy sentences rather than short, crisp presentation, what seems to you to be a modern, simple way of approaching, a direct way of conveying an idea, that's not necessarily in the author's voice, it may be in your voice. So I'm using voice in that sense, you know, to step into the shoes of that author, recognize, familiarize yourself with the way the argument is presented and the language, and then edit very carefully. I agree with Ritu entirely that all authors, the most well-published authors, need editors, need good editors, but that the reverse is also true, that all good authors don't need to be rewritten. Editing doesn't mean immediately that you have to intervene.
But I think that it's also the case very often that an insecure author will be much more difficult to edit. An author who is insecure is the one that really needs to be dealt with very gingerly, but very careful, but also requires much more work.
There are secure authors?
There are very secure authors who don't mind, no, who understand what the editor is trying to do. That's what I mean by secure. Confident. They don't think of it as an assault on their writing. They see it as an intervention that is beneficial. Okay. I remember speaking to that old wonderful director, the first director of the National Museum, Shivaramamurthy, a real scholar. Real scholar. He knew Chola bronzes and everything else backwards. He sent us, when I was working with Vikas, he sent a little book, just this big, maybe 100 pages or something, on Ganga, sculptural and other representations. You know, the page, it began on the top left-hand corner and ended in the bottom right-hand corner. The sentence. So how do you do that? So with great trepidation, because such a big name and such a well-known writer, and what the hell do I know about Chola bronzes or whatever it, no, that was Ganga. So I went to see him, taking two pages that I had with great sort of, you know, hesitation edited. He didn't even bother to look at them. He said, "My dear, I've done my job, you do your job. I'm not going to do your job. You know how to do your job, you please do it. Whatever you think needs to be done, you do it." Now, it's not something that many authors will tell you. I could say that he was just being, you know, he didn't want to bother. Maybe that's the case, but I don't think so. I don't think that was his reason. He understood that the way you write English may not be the way you write Sanskrit or whatever it is. That there is, for instance, in Urdu there's no punctuation. Can I possibly do it in English? Of course not. I can't. So I'm just saying that's a sort of rather, you know, silly analogy, but you know what I mean. Romila, another writer. My, what a turgid writer she is. Has anyone dared to edit her? No, because she's the great Romila Thakur. So she sends us a book, and I edit it. And I send it back to her. And she's taken aback. And she says, "You know, actually, yes, it's okay what you've done." And then she had the great humility and grace to say, "You know, it's the first time I'm working with literary texts. This is not my material. So you are at liberty and you were right to do what you did." She said that. Now she's totally confident. She's not, it's not an attack on her scholarship. That's what I mean by a secure author.
So we have reached the end of the session just now. Of course, the speakers are here. If you have any more questions for them, you can catch them at the tea break that follows. But before we end, I'd like to thank Ritu and Indu for being here with us today and doing this session. This is, before I give it to you, this is the traditional, this is scarves made out of the traditional Goan textile weave called the Kundi Saris. And this is the design that is that they weave for festive occasions. And we are here today for a very festive occasion. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Publishing Next, especially for this little last gift.